discussions my predecessors have done. So quickly running through the presentation, I know I don't want to be a hindrance between you all and the lunch that is served. So definitely understanding individual nutrition needs just to keep in mind. So quickly, I just wanted to reiterate the fact that I'm not a nutritionist, I'm an agriculturist, so just be mindful of how I'm going to, you know, sway the direction towards the agriculture, but to keep in mind that this is the food systems and the topic of a conference today that we are talking about. Food is both the key outcome of agricultural activities, but also it is the key input into good nutrition. While we continue to think from the health perspective of giving supplements, looking at fortification, food is by large the largest and the most important source of nutrition. And when we look at the pathways that Sunita actually laid out in terms of how the agriculture and nutrition kind of comes together, the sector is best placed to affect both food production and the consumption of nutritious foods for a healthy and active life. Just to, you know, throw a little bit more deep light into what are the different pathways that link the agriculture and nutrition framework, it is a source of food, as I explained before, but it is also the source of income for a majority of the population. The effects on agriculture policy, just to expand on the policy play around, has a direct impact on food. And just to take the whole argument of the WTO, how it actually impacts the food system. The effect on women's empowerment and employment, and finally how it can influence directly. Just a quick reiterate that I haven't seen the definition of food system since morning, so I just wanted to put that and flash that in, that it includes all processes and infrastructure that involves in feeding a population, which starts from growing and all the way into disposable food and food related items. So just to keep that in mind when we are discussing about the food systems per se. Just taking this photograph from the GloPan, the food production directly does not translate to food consumption or nutrition, and the systems are complex. And again, something that has an interlinkages with the global food trade, global markets, as well as the market dynamics. At a household level, the behaviors and food choices are both sensitive to income price diversity, but also the cultural aspects the whole household is encompassing in. Several drivers influence the food systems, and if we look at the food supply system as a whole, interventions in any one of those arms can impact the overall food supply system. So it's important that we consider an overall systems approach. We do not look at interventions that happen at one in the isolation, because then the overall food supply system can have an imbalance and again impact the overall nutrition of the community. When we talk about impact pathways, there are a few things that I just wanted to lay out up front. There's several studies that indicate that diversified food production systems influence the household food consumption. However, the impact of these are limited, primarily because there are two other step limiting factors, which is the income and the markets. All production interventions have two of these very key impact pathways that directly affect the food systems. And increasing in income directly translates to increase in food groups that are consumed by household. And if we just look at the way that, you know, increase in income actually translates, there is more movement towards processed foods, towards dairy, and towards fruits and vegetables to a limited extent. If we talk about a country in a globalized economy, what we are seeing more and more, that the food items consumed by a household are purchased rather than grown by the household itself. And thus the access to markets and availability of the food groups in those markets that are close to the house are extremely important in determining what the household consumes on a daily basis. Markets and food choices, again, are very complex and sensitive to income and price elasticity. And almost always, as the household income fluctuates between an increase and a decrease, it is the household expenses on the food that is the first impact. And hence, if you have seen a decrease in the household income over a time period, the first things that impact is the amount of food groups that particular household consumes. And here is just something that I just wanted to, like, you know, emphasize on the healthy diet paradox. While we see an increase in the food availability across the countries, there has been mostly around calorie security. Because there has been more and more consumption of calories versus diversified foods. And diets have improved but not transformed to a quality diet. And it is important that we keep that this is happening across the income quintile. It is not only happening in the lower income or in the middle income, it is happening across the income quintile. And if we consider the nutrient value of food item and consumption patterns, dairy, eggs and pulses are high priority nutrient dense food consumed in very, very low quantity. And hence these should be prioritized from both production-facing interventions, diversity, as well as in market access interventions, because it is these three that can have a direct impact on the nutrition per se. And again, something that is an unexplored alternative, which is the animal source foods. They are more dense in nutrients, but they need to be consumed adequately to impact nutrition. At the current level of consumption, the majority of the population does not have adequate bioavailable macro or micronutrients coming out of the animal source. Just to give you a little bit down deep on the income pathway, disposable income translates to foods directly. However, if you look at the inequity in income, it translates to both the quantity as well as the quality of the food consumed. As income increases, the food consumption, as I mentioned before, includes more dairy and processed foods. But if you look at the on the right side of the graph, if you see, there are these two boxes where these changes are more or less increasing across the income quintile. It doesn't only happen in the lower or the middle, it also happens in the richest income quintile. And here is a myth that I would like to bust. If you just take the case of protein, the dietary diversity that we currently have is not very different between the rural urban population or between the rich or the poor population. We still have a higher proportion of our diets still concentrated around cereals, very little around pulses, and then there are other foods that are forming the composition, but if you look at anywhere between 30% to 70% of the diet still constituted by the cereals. Now moving a little bit away from the income side to look at the food market systems map. This is how a typical food market system map looks like, and this is apart from the PDS commodities. There is a farmer, there's a village merchant, and how the market plays, and there is a consumer at the end of it. This food market actually, there are different points of sale and purchase. It is imperative that the functioning markets not only drives the production or the production diversity, but also it is important that markets are critical for technology adoption. Thus, if a market is demanding a product which is a higher nutrient quality, the farmer will produce it because there is a market that is existing. So what we have to look at is not from the production side or what we call a supply side, but to start looking at nutrition from the demand side as well, and to see how we can modify the demand through behavior change communication, through better information, and see how we can modify the production diversity that is happening at the farm. And something that I'm grappling in between, how are we looking at a logical framework when we're really bringing food systems to deliver, particularly from an agriculture system? There are some basic questions that we're having, and I'm just posing an example of dairy. Why are we looking at that particular food group? What is it that we are looking at, and how are we going to look at, but also where are we looking at? If we concentrate our efforts on nutrient dense foods and develop intensive strategies that can tweak the agriculture systems for the what and how, and then we can actually have the agriculture systems deliver on food systems, and that is an interplay of value chains. We cannot look at one value chain in isolation of the other. It is important that if we tweak on one side, as I was showing the food supply system map, that any intervention on one end can actually have a ripple effect on the others. Just to delve a little bit deep down on dairy, and it forms an integral part of the Indian diet, and if we just look at the RDA like, you know, here in this platform, I don't want to get into the details, but amongst the northern states where milk is a preferred part of the diet, the Punjab and Haryana are only those where you have average per capita consumption is above the 300 grams, that is RDA. The rest are not. And one thing that you have to be mindful of, that food, milk consumption is extremely sensitive to prices. Out of the most food items, it is the one that is, like, you know, very dependent on the lean and on the flush season. Its price increase does not only impact the consumption of milk. This is something that is very paradoxical. It also influences the consumption of pulses, because when the disposable available incomes in a household has extreme sensitivity to prices, increase in commodity price of one actually offsets your availability of other food. And in terms of the dairy market and accessibility, again, I don't want to get into the details, but it is important that we consider a value chain approach to the food system. We address the several fault lines that could increase the affordability and availability of the nutritious foods. Just to look at the dairy value chain, there are three important entry points where we're looking at availability, increasing productivity, and also in terms of the accessibility. If we just focus on one entry point, we can identify the drivers and challenges that can be addressed. And I'm just, like, you know, rushing through this, but, you know, happy to have a discussion later on. But just quickly, I wanted to, you know, put this out in terms of the key conclusions and takeaways. As a sector, agriculture is best placed to affect the food production and consumption. The systems are complex and interlinked with the global trade and market dynamics. It's important to consider that the household behaviors are sensitive to income, price, diversity, and cultural aspects. And the two important pathways that we have to consider are income and markets. If we have a functioning food market that not only drives the production, but also the diversity, incomes, and adoption of technology, the poorest are extremely dependent on markets for food, because more and more we are seeing that it's the purchased food which makes up for their household consumption pattern. So just the final line, production diversity, access to markets, and available incomes have to coexist to transform the agriculture systems to deliver on efficient food systems. Thank you. Thank you.